morning, church. Would you stand as we open with praise to our God? Welcome this morning to Louisville Grace Community Church of the Nazarene. We're so glad that you're with us, that you've joined us today, that whether it's the folks that have rejoined us this week in the sanctuary, woohoo, we're glad to be back together, or if you're online watching us, what a wonderful morning for worship it is. And I'm going to pray, and I'd ask that you would join me in it. Father, we are so thankful that you give us the freedom to worship on this morning. And so, God, may we use this time wisely And what I mean by that is that, Lord, that you are the highlight of everything that we do today. Yes, when we come into your presence, there's great benefit to us. But, Lord, may you be glorified above all things. And so this morning, it's yours. We turn it over to you. Our hearts, our minds, our attentions, everything is yours today. And it is the wonderful name of Jesus we pray all of these things together. And the church said, amen. Church, you can be seated for a moment. I'm going to welcome up Pastor Allie. We're going to share some announcements, but we have a very special one to begin with. And so, Allie, I'll give it to you. Take it away.
Good morning. So, we all know this past year has been rough. COVID has definitely thrown things out of whack. One of the wonderful things that we get to do is we get to participate in outreach programs. And I have a way, and I've been connected with a local elementary school. And we're partnering with them as well as two other churches that I know of. And we are going to bless the staff at that elementary school. I'm not going to tell you which one in case they're watching because they have no idea what we're doing. COVID throws everything off. COVID throws a lot of things off for teachers. The kids are not in school. The teachers have been taught how to teach these children in school, in a building. They have had to adapt so much to this online. Not only some of them had to learn how to use the online stuff, now they have to adapt and learn how to teach these children online when they're at home with a ton of distractions. Yep. Their toys, their beds, there's food, you know. It's hard, but we have a way and an in to be a blessing to these teachers who are working so hard and have done a fantastic job teaching our kids in this strange time. So we are launching a program called Adopt a Teacher. We have asked them to fill out surveys, these people to fill out surveys. They have no idea why we asked them to fill out surveys. But it has on there some likes or dislikes and just stuff a little bit about them. And I have each individual paper with each person on it that you can adopt a teacher. You can sign up to take one of these teachers, look at their list, look at their likes, look at their dislikes, come up, let your creativity flow, come up with some kind of a gift basket or just a little care package for them. Then we are going to collect all these care packages. We are going to go to the elementary school the day before spring break. And we are going to have a drive-through type event where the teachers are going to drive through the school. They don't know why. They're just going to be asked to come to the school. And we are going to give them their care package. Amen. That is specifically designed for each individual person. So I'm really, really excited that we get to bless these teachers who are doing so much and going way beyond and above for our kids. So it's very, very exciting. So I have a nice little packet here. If you are wanting to adopt a teacher, come find me after service. I will hook you up with a teacher and all their likes and dislikes. You can go out and make a care package for them, bring it back here once it's finished to the church, and then we'll get together with the elementary school and deliver these packages. Amen. I'm really excited for this, guys. It's wonderful to be able to just do something little to show our appreciation for the giant impact that teachers make on our children.
Thank you, Allie. And from what I understand, this is an inter-church event, too. So this is happening at Nazarene churches around this area, correct?
There are three different churches, our church, two other churches, that are taking, there are 53 staff members that we are blessing.
Yeah.
So it's being divided between.
Fantastic. So, this is an area-wide thing, and we want to participate. We want to overwhelm our teachers with kindness and grace. Let them know that Jesus loves them so much that he would work through the body
to bless them during this time. So, we believe in that. I have a few other announcements to share with you this morning, some more standard stuff. Remember, we are still assembling journey kits through the first week of February. And so if you have been doing that, if you have been working on accruing the items to put those together, we're still taking those through the 7th. And so we have one more week. There is the treasure box in the sanctuary that you can fill those journey kits in. So make sure that if you haven't already done it and you've planned to, go ahead and put those in. We want to bless as many people as we can who are cold and hungry during this time. Also want to remind you that February is Alabaster Month. We've already distributed the boxes. We will be taking Alabaster offering the last Sunday of February. And so just keep that in mind. We have approached the Alabaster Month. And so I also want to let you know that this Wednesday we are having our Bible study. I will still be working. We had an experimental in-person and online hybrid Bible study this last week, and it went as well as humanly could be expected. We are not having our typical Mission Wednesday this week. That will be the week following. So this week is our standard Bible study. And so we invite you to that. I also want to remind you, especially since we've not been together for the last couple of weeks, if you have been a regular attender here, if you have been toying with the idea of joining the church in membership, whether you're in here or whether you're online, we are hosting a new membership class that will be on Saturday, February 13th at 10 a.m. If you let me know ahead of time, we'll have lunch ready for you. We're going to teach you about what the Church of the Nazarene believes. There's no pressure to join at the end. However, you do got to go through this to join. And so if you've been thinking about it, now is the time. So we invite you to be a part of that. And if you are not able to make the Saturday session, then we will make a special session available for you. I will meet with you individually whatever time you can, because we want to welcome you into the body. We would love to have you be a regular participant in it, and so we don't want to let anything to stand in the way of that. I believe, yes, that is the end of our announcements. I want us to go back now, turn our minds to him, and to do so, I'm going to welcome up Larry, who's going to share our morning scripture with us. Response to that, church, may we stand and continue to give him praise.
Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love. Souls atoned by the blood of the Lamb. I'm not a slave to wants. Wants held me down. How beautiful that cleansing flood. I am washed, I am drenched in blood. Singing, oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. was buried deep with Christ my Lord, and now I'm raised to life forevermore. My name's been carved upon your heart. No, not death, no, not hell could ever rip us apart. Singing, oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow.
Gonna let me down. Oh, you're never gonna let me down.
God is holding on. Worship His Majesty. Unto Jesus be all glory, honor, and praise. Majesty, kingdom, authority, flow from His throne unto His own.
Thank you for everything you do for us, for being the one who was of surpassing value to us, the one who is above all other things, the one who is king on high, the one who is majestic beyond compare, the one, Lord, to whom we consider all other things garbage in light of who you are. May our hearts, our attitudes, our actions, our priorities, everything we do, Lord, not just in here, but in our lives as we do everything that we do, Lord, reflect that understanding that you are of supreme importance above all other things. We love you. Be glorified, we pray. For it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Church, you can be seated. We're going to resume the giving of our tithes and offerings through the placement of our tithes, basically in the back. You'll see that there's a table with an offering plate back there. If you'd like to at this time, during this next song, you can go and place them there. You can also place them at the end of service, but we want to reserve a time to remember that when we surrender everything to Him, it's our hearts, it's our attitudes, it's our minds, it's our time, it's our everything. It's of the physical things that He gives us as well, and so we want to give to Him in obedience. We want to give to Him in joy, and so we remember that now during this time. Father, thank you for supplying all of our needs. We have far more, Lord, than we deserve, and you are so gracious to us. And so we respond in obedience and thank you, God, for doing all that you do for us. You spared nothing, not even your own Son. For it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer?
is no more for heaven now to give. He's my joy, my righteousness, and my freedom. My steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. For my life is wholly bound to this. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. The night is dark, but I am not forsaken. For by my side, the Savior, he will say, I labor on in weakness and rejoicing. For in my need, his power is displayed. To this I hold, my shepherd will defend me. Through the deepest valley, he Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and he was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hold, my sin has been defeated. Jesus now and ever is my plea. Oh, the chains are released, I can sing. Jesus, for he has said that he will bring me home, and day by day I know he will renew me, until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, all the glory evermore to him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, all the glory evermore to him. Shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Yet not I, but through Christ in me.
To follow him. And now, kids, I ask that you would follow Miss Allie. to Children's Church. It's time for us to get into the scriptures today, and I know that the kids are going to love it. They're going to learn about Jesus today, and I'm always humbled that we have such a wonderful teacher for our kids. Church, if you have your Bibles with you, I'm going to ask that you would turn again to Luke chapter 11. We've been in chapter 11 for the last few weeks as we go through this series, Dear Theo, which is it concentrates on the entire Gospel of Luke, and soon enough we'll go through the book of Acts together as we discover this one continuous letter that was written to Theophilus concerning the very beginning, the roots of the gospel, all the way up through the launching of the church. And what a wonderful gospel it is, because it concentrates so heavily on the acts of Jesus, the miracles of Jesus. And in this one, we concentrate on the wisdom of Jesus as he is inquired of. And so we're going to begin this morning again as we start in chapter 11. We're going to start with verse 29. And so if you have your Bibles with you, I read out of the New International Version. You may have a different one. However, we have the words on the screen. And if you at home, you'll have the words up for you as well. But before I do that, a little more time for prayer. Father, it does not escape me every morning when we do this, the preciousness of your word. Sometimes we read a lot of it. Sometimes we read just a few verses. But Lord, I pray that every single word that is contained in this book, Lord, that your Spirit would speak wisdom beyond our comprehension from it. And Lord, that we in return, that we would treat this as if it were the greatest treasure on earth. That we would guard it with everything that we have, and that we would consume it as if it were the tastiest thing that had ever been put before us. Don't let us ever take this word for granted, because Lord, we may not always have it. But for now, we are blessed. And so speak, Lord, we listen. Thank you again for it. And thank you for your Son, Jesus, in whom we pray. Amen. We begin in verse 29. 29 says, "As the crowds increased, Jesus said, 'This is a wicked generation. It asks for a sign, but none will be given to it, or given it, except the sign of Jonah. For as Jonah was a sign to the Ninevites, so also will the Son of Man be to this generation.'" Verse 31 says, "The queen of the south will rise at the judgment with the people of this generation and condemn them. For she came from the ends of the earth to listen to Solomon's wisdom, and now something greater than Solomon is here. The men of Nineveh will stand up at the judgment with this generation and condemn it, for they repented at the preaching of Jonah, and now something greater than Jonah is here." That's the passage this week, and out of context, it may seem a little difficult to understand, and so I want us to know from the very beginning, verse 29 is referring back to last week's passage. If you remember, Jesus had cast a demon out of someone, and there were three different reactions. A good portion of the crowd was amazed and astonished at what Jesus had accomplished. There was another crew that came and conspired against Jesus and said, "Oh, he's only doing this exorcism in the power of Beelzebub, or the prince of demons. So by demons, he's casting out demons." And we addressed that whole thing last week. As of course, as we covered last week, that would be the same thing as invoking a demonic civil war. It would make no real amount of sense for this to take place in Jesus, that demons would be fighting against demons because they wanted to gain territory, not lose it to themselves. But there was another crowd, a third group of people, after Jesus had performed this miraculous healing, this exorcism, that seeing the miracles of Jesus asked for one thing: verification. It was a group that had asked for some kind of sign. They wanted to know, is this really the one? Is this the Messiah?
Is this the king? How do we know? Jesus, we need a sign. Give us something. And on the surface, it seems incredibly reasonable. I know that in my lifetime, there have been times and places where I wasn't sure if God was speaking to me, or even in my younger days when I was still looking for a sign from God that he was even real. And I would ask for things like, God, you know, if you really are real, then may a pile of cash end up on the end of my bed when I wake up in the morning. Would you believe that never happened? I wanted a sign. And I think a lot of us, perhaps in our prayers, at least at some point in our lives, have asked God for some sort of sign that what he is saying or what we are wanting is real. And it is to this group that asked Jesus for a sign that Jesus begins to offer his second defense and response. That's where we come in verse 29. He says, a wicked generation asked for a sign, right? That's what it says in verse 29. The crowds increased. Jesus said, this is a wicked generation. It asks for a sign, but none will be given it except the sign of Jonah. Why are they wicked? Why on earth would Jesus call them wicked? I believe it's because they already see Jesus in their midst doing wonderful, incredible work, and yet they refuse to believe. This is not an isolated incident from Jesus. It's not as if this is the first thing that he has done in the region in order to gain the confidence of those who are around him. It's not as if Jesus, when he went to different villages, didn't already have people flocking around him because they have heard about his miracles far and wide. If they haven't seen a sign, to be honest with you, the truth is they're either not paying attention or they are ignoring Jesus altogether, on purpose, putting their heads in the sand, hiding under a rock. Since the beginning of Jesus' ministry in Luke, we've already been all the way through the first 11 and a half chapters of Luke. This is what we got. Since the beginning of Jesus' ministry, Jesus has done these things. He has fed 5,000 people with someone's lunch. He has raised a dead girl. He has healed a sick woman. He has exorcised demon after demon. He has calmed a raging storm with the sound of his voice. He has raised the dead son of a widow. He has healed the dying servant of a centurion from long distance, by the way. Gave movement back to a paralytic, gave health back to a leper, and that's after the beginning of his ministry with the audible and tangible voice of love from the Father coming down from the heavens in witness of numerous crowds around him, and rash after rash of healings after leaving the wilderness. And that's just the stuff that's documented. You know, Scripture doesn't have the whole of what Jesus accomplished in his ministry. That's just what we have leading up into this verse. Jesus does more. If those in his midst hadn't seen those things happen, they had certainly heard about them. Jesus' reputation precedes itself. And as Jesus hears these demands for proof, it's as if Jesus has shown up to the courtroom being accused, and he has videos, he has tangible examples, he has thousands of testimonies in his favor, he has a watertight alibi, and the jury is like, yeah, but where's the evidence? It doesn't make sense. Everything about what he has done has suggested that he's the real deal, and he does it again right in front of them, and they say, yeah, but we need a sign. What are you missing, people? Can't you see the sign is right before you? That is why Jesus calls them wicked. That's why he refuses to indulge the request for another sign. They've already gotten them. They've already gotten every sign they would ever need. Instead, he uses some reference that perhaps we're not all that familiar with. So we're going to go through that just a little bit. Let's explore this for a moment. Now, continuing in verse 29, this is the way it ends. He says, no sign will be given except the sign of Jonah. Well, you may know who Jonah is, but what is the sign of Jonah? What is he talking about here in this place? Well, let's just assume maybe you haven't heard of Jonah. This is one a lot of our kids that grew up in the church will know. If you know the story, you know, Jonah in the belly of the whale, that whole idea. Jonah was a reluctant Old Testament prophet. Emphasis on the reluctant. He didn't want to do it. He made that very clear. In fact, the whole story is about him not wanting to do it and then finally giving in and seeing the results of what God does. Jonah was a reluctant Old Testament prophet, and God wants to use him to go preach repentance to a people called the Ninevites to the north. Jonah instead, because he doesn't want those people to receive God's grace, runs in the other direction, off to the northwest. Because he doesn't like the Ninevites. And he knows if they hear the voice of God, they're going to repent and God's going to take it easy on them. He doesn't want God to take it easy on the Ninevites. He doesn't like them. And so in Jonah's running and in Jonah's disobedience, he's cast into the sea on the boat that he is fleeing in, only to be swallowed up by a big fish. Some would say a whale. For 3 days and for 3 nights, Jonah, miraculously alive in the belly of the whale, spends it in prayer. God changes his heart. I guess there would be a lot of things that would change your heart in a moment of mortal peril. The fish spews Jonah back up onto dry land, and this time Jonah does go to Nineveh. He gets a second chance. Good for you, Jonah. They hear the words. They hear the call of God from Jonah's lips. They humble themselves. The Ninevites do. The Ninevites humble themselves. They fast. They repent. And God relents of his anger toward Nineveh. So on one hand, Jesus says to this crowd that's asking for a sign, no sign will be given to you except for the sign of Jonah. Well, what is the sign of Jonah? Well, so many believe that on one hand, the sign that Jesus gives is that he too will be swallowed up into the earth for 3 days. And on the third day, will reemerge. And people will repent. They will fall on their face at his knees, and they will worship him, and he will come in glory. Just like the same way that Jonah was swallowed up for 3 days and then burst back and forth on the land. The sign of Jonah is this idea of death and resurrection in the belly of something perilous, emerging once again. But they would only see the sign once Jesus had completed his ministry on earth. And I believe that that is extremely relevant. Jonah was swallowed up and returned miraculously. He says, you'll see the signs when I resurrect. But there's also this truth that Jonah, all that Jonah had to do, and this is what Jesus refers to in this passage, all that Jonah had to do for the people of Nineveh to fall on their face before God was go. That was it. Go, and I mean, he didn't even want to. He went, and he's probably like, okay, so God says if you don't repent, there he's going to destroy your village. All right, I did my duty. Probably something along those lines. I can imagine that that's the way Jonah went at it, because you can, if you look at the rest of Jonah, the rest of the story, he's angry that God relented against the Ninevites. It still didn't change his heart all that much. All that Jonah did was go and do what he had to do. And the Ninevites were moved to action with tears and repentance and genuine acts of contrition. This is what it says in verse 30. It says, for Jonah was a sign to the Ninevites, so also will the Son of Man be to this generation. Jesus has shown up. And let me tell you, Jesus has shown up with a great deal more conviction than Jonah ever showed up for the Ninevites. With a great deal more power behind his name and eagerness to share this message with the people. The Ninevites fell on their face. The people right here that Jesus has encountered with saying, show us a sign. These were people that didn't even like one another, but Jonah to Nineveh was a sign. He continues in verse 31. Then he says, the queen of the south will rise at the judgment with the people of this generation and condemn them, for she came from the ends of the earth to listen to Solomon's wisdom, and now something greater than Solomon is here. What does that even mean? The queen of the south? will rise in judgment. The first time I read this passage a long while ago, I thought he was talking about Dolly Parton. Not Dolly Parton, Dolly Parton. I wanted to jump right to the last name. He's not talking about Dolly, I found out. It said she came from the ends of the earth to listen to Solomon, and now something greater than Solomon is here. Now, the reference that Jesus makes is almost certainly in regard to the Queen of Sheba. If you know your Old Testament history, in 1 Kings chapter 10, there is an account of her visit to see the spectacle that is Solomon's splendor. And this, we're actually going to read this passage. I want you to know what takes place here in 1 Kings chapter 10. So we're going to read the first 9 verses together. What it says is, when the Queen of Sheba heard about the fame of Solomon and his relationship to the Lord, she came to test Solomon with hard questions. And arriving at Jerusalem with a very great caravan with camels carrying spices, large quantities of gold and precious stones, she came to Solomon and talked with him about all that she had on her mind. Solomon answered all her questions, and nothing was too hard for the king to explain to her. And when the Queen of Sheba saw all the wisdom of Solomon and the palace he had built, the food on his table, the seating of his officials, the attending servants in their robes, his cupbearers, and the burnt offerings he made at the temple of the Lord, she was overwhelmed. She said to the king, "The report I heard in my own country about your achievements and your wisdom is true. But I did not believe these things until I came and saw with my own eyes. Indeed, not even half was told to me. In wisdom and wealth, you have far exceeded the report I heard. How happy your people must be. How happy your officials who continually stand before you and hear your wisdom. Praise be to the Lord your God, who has delighted in you and placed you on the throne of Israel. Because of the Lord's eternal love for Israel, he has made you king to maintain justice and righteousness." A pagan queen came to visit Solomon, and in just viewing what God had done and hearing the words from Solomon's lips, she came to know that there is a God above all other gods. Amen. The Queen of the South that's referred to in Luke 11. What this meant is that Solomon achieved such renown that people from distant lands traveled to see what God has done. People of foreign cultures, people of foreign gods came and recognized God's hand. Yet here was the Son of God in Luke 11. The Son of God, not a king, not a prophet, the Son of God in their midst. He is ushering in the kingdom with power unmatched and wisdom unlimited. And this is what this generation says: we need to see evidence. No one had ever done the things that Jesus had done. No one had ever come close to doing and accomplishing what Jesus had accomplished. The Queen of the South rises in judgment. Solomon was but a man with riches and wisdom supplied by God, yet it was enough for a queen to recognize what God was doing. The Queen of the South rises in judgment. Verse 32 says, the men of Nineveh will stand up at the judgment with this generation and condemn it, for they repented at the preaching of Jonah, and now something greater than Jonah is here. If these people can recognize God's work, what is wrong with you? You don't want to hear the truth. You don't want to know the truth. You ask for a sign. I say every sign you ever need is before you and more. Man, all the people in Nineveh had was Jonah, and they repented, and Jonah was an angry, disobedient, reluctant man, hardly filled with conviction, but he listened, and eventually they responded. I believe that Jesus is saying to the people here in this passage, asking for a sign, do you not understand the privilege that you have in this moment? God is with you. That name Emmanuel, it's not just a pretty name. God is with you. God is with you. And you ask for a sign. He comes in power. He comes in authority. And if they could respond, if the people of the earth could respond to God through those two, Jonah and Solomon, how are you missing this? Do you not understand the privilege you've been given? Jesus is here. Generation upon generation upon generation would not have only listened and obeyed Jesus in this moment. Not only would they have been utterly embarrassed to demand signs from one who had such power and wisdom, but they would have fallen at his feet in reverence. Not begged for more evidence. What's going on with this generation? What's the matter? But then again, perhaps this isn't such a difficult idea to grasp after all. We too are a people with incredible privilege. Oh, we are. We're blessed beyond belief. We have access to the Holy Spirit and to His Scriptures like no people has ever had before. It's abundant. It's all over the place. We can have it any time we want to. We can connect with God at any time. We are a people of privilege. What is this? Would you agree that this is the holy and inspired Word of God? Is that not what we believe as those who profess to follow Jesus? That the words in here are true and accurate and everything we need to know the heart of the Father and everything we would ever need to have salvation? We believe that this is the holy and inspired Word of God. I spoke last week about how we've got to stop carrying the banners of every other broken thing that purports to give us some sort of victory over evil forces in this life. We cannot follow anyone but Jesus. We cannot hang ourselves under any other banner but Him. No politician is going to save us. No ideology is going to save us. No movement is going to save us unless it is a movement toward Jesus. Right? I had an email this week suggesting that I should expand on how we may better do that. Well, how can we be a people that better unite under Jesus in obedience, praise, and service? I say that transition always begins with a change in prayer, and that is true. We have got to be a people that pray. But there are times, right, when it seems near impossible to hear the voice of God. It's hard to be a praying people when you feel like you're not getting anything back. I'm not saying it's impossible. I feel like we should push through those things. But you want a prayer aid? Here you go. You want to hear the voice of God in your prayers? Here you go. Take this with you. Make it a huge part of your prayer time. You want to hear from God? He'll speak directly through His Word. His Word. His Word. His Word, right? It's His Word. If you're reading it, it's as if He's speaking to you. And His Holy Spirit will inspire you with brand new revelation. I'm reminded of a comic strip that I see pop up every once in a while when I'm on social media with stuff. It's called Coffee with Jesus. And it's got a lady who's having coffee with Jesus and sitting down, and she says, you know, it's hard to keep praying when I don't hear you. And Jesus responds to her. He says, well, do you read the Bible? Do you have a Bible with you? And she says, yeah, but sometimes I really just want an audible voice to speak to me. And He says, have you tried reading Scripture out loud? It's the same idea. No matter how you look at it, if you are a Christian and you believe that this book is holy and that this book is the inspired Word of God, there is no higher authority than God. Go to the book. You want a sign? Here it is. And we are so privileged to have it at our disposal at all times. So privileged. We don't know it. We don't understand it. We've always had it. We take it for granted. What we have before us, So many people have not. People have fought and died for scraps of this document. We treat it so casually. It was John Wycliffe in the 14th century who knew that the likely penalty for promoting an English translation of the Bible was death. And yet he knew that there was nothing more valuable to the people of God than to know the Word of God. Giving access to the Scripture to the poor meant likely execution in the church in the 14th century. He was mercilessly persecuted by the powers within the church, but venerated by the poor. In their desperation, the common people gobbled up Scripture with feverish hunger. As English became available, as they were able to actually read or hear the words of Scripture in their own language, it had been in Latin, they couldn't understand a word of it. As it became available in their own language, they were feverishly gobbling up the words of Scripture that they had never had before. They would sit up all night just to be able to hear the Word of God in English. They would give massive quantities of their only dispensable income just to have one book of the Bible at their disposal. It was William Tyndale who translated and championed the English version of Scripture and was burned at the stake for his efforts. It's a precious book. Even then, that there are those who would give anything they owned for just a few pages or chapters of the epistles of Paul or the Gospel of John. People that would give everything just to have a glimpse at the Word. We are a people of privilege. We have more access to the Word than ever, and yet the vast majority of Christians, do we appreciate what we have in our hands? Or what we have on display in our homes? We have spent more time picking out, maybe not all of us, but a lot of us have spent more time picking out our Bible totes than we have actually picking through our Bible. Have we spent more time picking out our Bible totes than reading what they are toting? Does the Bible receive veneration above all other household belongings but remains closed? There are Christians, and I'm not exaggerating, there are Christians all over the place whose entire experience with the Word consists of what they have heard in sermons, or what they have seen in small snippets and devotional books here and there, or in Bible studies, or what they have seen framed in inspirational gifts, or what they have never, they've never read this book from beginning to end. There are people that are Christians that have never actually read the story of God. I find that very, very difficult to do. How do you know what you believe if you've never read it? I implore you, church. If you don't know this book, you will not recognize Jesus when He moves. You will make decisions based on what you have heard about this book. You will make decisions and marry them to independent scriptures separated from any knowledge of the moving story of God from the beginning of creation, through a people that He called His own, through a world that He redeemed, through the blood of His Son Jesus. You will never know the full character of God if you do not know His story. I implore you, church, if you do not know this book, if it is not familiar to you, when Jesus moves, you're probably going to be asking for a sign when He's already given it. Or if He does, you'll need to be extra sure that it's Him When he says jump, you'll want a safety net. When he says go, you'll say, let me just give this a little extra time to get a better, more peaceful feeling about it. But so much of what we need to know is right here. Do you want God to speak to you? Do you want him to transform you through the power of his word? It is all right here. We've just got to ask him to reveal himself as we read. As we pour through it, we ask the Spirit to speak to us in brand new ways. Church, we have privilege upon privilege upon privilege right in these pages, and we don't even realize what we have. If we're not digging into the book, we are basing everything we do, our leadership, our decision-making, our hopes, our eternities, our entire lives, on words that someone else has said about this book. Don't take my word for it. Read it. It's time for us to stop meeting with him through a mediator. It's time for us to meet with him face to face. He's waiting. Pray, seek, read, and then when he moves, you won't need a sign. Church, would you pray with me? Father, I thank you again for the preciousness of your word. I thank you that even today we have such a wealth of knowledge of who you are that we can know you so intimately, Lord, that when you move, God, there's no doubt that you are already in progress, that you are already doing something new for the kingdom. God, why do we doubt so much? I believe it's because we don't really know you. And so, God, I know there are so many in here that love you and want to know you and want to connect with you and want to be so close with you. Would you create within our hearts a hunger, a desire for your word that is not satisfied with snippets but wants the whole thing? That's not satisfied with studying small passages but wants to know how you have moved from the beginning of history all the way until when this earth is done and a new heaven and a new earth are in place. God, we need to know you. And God, I believe that if we pour into your word, that will transform us from the inside out. May we be a people that are always on the move, always part of your story. God, convict us when we haven't. And God, I don't want to leave us here sulking. What I also know is that you are a God of great grace. And that God, if we've been slacking in that, if we haven't been in your word, you're not here to beat us over the head. You're here to offer an invitation, a warm invitation, to your table. God, may we graciously accept that invitation, and may we dine, and may we fill ourselves with everything good that you offer. We don't have to come on our with our faces on the floor. You don't expect us to grovel every time we come into your presence. Lord, may we accept the invitation and find joy in it. We love you. We are your people. It is in the wonderful and holy and precious name of Jesus we pray. And the church said together, amen. Now may that same Spirit that was present when this was written and as we read it, follow you and speak to you new truths in your homes, with your families, in your restaurants, in your cars, wherever you go. May that God go with you. Church, you are loved. You are prayed for. Have a wonderful Sunday and a wonderful week. You are dismissed.